I can learn to hunt in the end anyway, but exactly. I can't necessarily go and fucking find armor plates and shit when the world is over, you know what I'm saying? But
yeah,
I don't even know.
If Pence isn't living in a bubble right now for just the continuity of government at this point, something's wrong.
Right.
So
I don't have any particular sympathy for Boeing, especially in this time, getting money from the government. You're like, oh, we're fucking struggling, airlanes and shit. Like, you sold planes that didn't work and you knew it. That's what you fucking get, right?
Oh, yeah. So
yeah, no, we're good. All right. We're fucking swaggins. We're out here. We are live. Episode 94. Live stream pre-show, salt of the streets.
Let me give you your close-up.
Yeah,
here.
We're
Look
doing it.
This.
Thank you. We obviously have a nice little setup that we have going on here. We are slapping out. We're here.
Slapping out.
Yeah, I wasn't.
I don't know.
I wasn't sure.
I don't know what that
going,
means.
But we're doing it. We're going hard. And there's an episode of the League. And I don't know if you've ever seen that show before. There's a character named Pete, and he is played by, what the fuck is that guy's name?
Pete. He's not the 9/11 dude,
no,
right?
No, okay. Not that one. This guy has actually like reached out to Ben Shapiro before, and then Mark Duplass.
Mark Duplass.
Yes. And he plays a guy named Pete, and I don't know what his job is, but he's like talking to his boss. His boss is trying to give him, he's like, just I need you to get this thing done. And he's like yeah, certainly, it's
sure.
It's a full team effort, you know. And he's like, well, no, just to be clear, like, you're the only one I've asked to get this done. And he's like, yeah, no, we're, you know, it's a full send and we're blah blah blah. And he's like, just say yes, like, tell me that you can do this. And he's like, yeah, I will absolutely do it. He's just going on and on, and that's exactly how I felt. Was so we're doing it.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for joining us. Episode 94 pre-show. Quick shout out to Olivia, because we had some sucker souffle last night. Olivia
snap.
Has been making chocolate souffles like the last 2 weeks.
Just kind of got on a binge.
I don't know why she did it the first time.
Something to do with Larry King.
Larry King's dope.
Yeah,
so.
Something. either way, yeah, she ended up making a chocolate souffle while John's mom was here. And then when John's mom left, she made more and she gave some to us. And they're fucking... Holy shit.
That doesn't surprise me.
I've had 3 chocolate souffles over the last 2 weeks.
Whoa.
I'm telling you.
Whoa.
I'm fucking spoiled. That night that I made that crazy pasta, we then went and had chocolate souffles over at Olivia's house.
Yes. Dope. That's a high caloric day right
it's
there.
It's been great.
Totally
it's
worth
been,
it.
Yeah. That pasta. What? Oh, yeah. When did you eat? Before we continue. I got this. Don't. I can. We're fucking like 4 minutes in. I got this. I don't need to. I can do it. I don't.
So to answer your question, I had a lovely breakfast sandwich. I made it on that waterfront sourdough, the Seattle waterfront sourdough that's like this big.
Yeah.
And so I did half was chicken sausage and half was bacon. And then egg and, you know, the normal stuff.
No deer sausage? What's...
No, it's still over at my...
Oh.
I try to limit my deer intake now.
Really? Why?
Because there's...
Only so much?
There's only so much.
Okay.
So I'm trying to spread it out. Because unless I start getting some more animals...
Yeah, it just means you gotta get out and start getting after it.
Yeah.
Sounds
it
like
definitely
you're in
means
a,
that.
What does Steve Renell call it? A meat crisis.
I am in a meat crisis.
Yeah.
As it were.
Time to get cracking. You know
so,
what I'm
but I did make some new venison steaks this week, which they were just so basically because my mom and I work together, right?
Yes.
I have this kind of setup now where since all the meat's over at her house
in
my brother's freezer, I just kind of put an order in the day before I want some venison.
And your mom.
And I'm like, all right, Ma. So this is what I want right now. I want just in the freezer, all of my packages have my name on it. My brothers don't have any names on it. So mine are just, you know. And I was like, anything that says roast and my initials, just grab that and bring it. So she brings me the biggest one.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, cool. So then I sent you that picture the other night of all those steak cuts.
Oh, yes.
So that's actually just off of like a rump roast had kind of binded before I froze it. So it's nice and solid. And then... partially defrosted it and then cut some fatty steaks out of them. And then I still had half a roast left. So tonight we're having the other half of the actual roast. But yeah, I made steaks for that night and then everybody's various lunches the next day.
Yeah.
And they were I mean, you, dude, you hit those things because there's like no fat on them.
Right. At right. All.
So you hit those things on the hot barbecue out there. Mm-hmm. I got some mesquite lump charcoal, not like the briquettes kind.
Yeah, yeah.
I went super fancy, as it turned out. And I had no idea what I was buying. I was like, oh, sweet. This is good quality charcoal.
Yeah.
But got nice and hot, dude. And they were on there for maybe 2.5 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, and they were probably they were a solid medium rare. But, like, as it turns out, when I'm cooking venison now, like, it basically just needs to be warmed.
Right.
You know?
When we cooked them, because you guys, you and Chad, obviously gave us those steaks. Thank you again, Chad. Shout out, Chad. Shout out, Chad, and his full boog gear today.
Oh, yeah, dude.
And
I think that was yesterday, but that's fine.
Either way. But when I made those, I pan-fried those steaks, and I put them in maybe 2 minutes, like, on each side. You know what I'm saying? Because you get just that one big fat piece, so I, like, cut it down the middle. Because I was, like, I did that. I was like, oh, yeah, we'll just have these steaks. And then after I did, I just cut them up into those slices anyway, because it was fucking so beautiful.
Yeah, right. But it's hard not to with that beautiful meat.
So, yeah, exactly. Yeah, so I maybe cooked for like 2 minutes on each side, and it was still super pink in the middle. And yeah, even I took the rest like for lunch the next day, you know, and even microwaved and like almost well done, it was still so fucking fire. Yes. Like, still so good.
Dude, I'm so glad that it's worked out this way. Because, I mean, I've had venison before.
Yeah.
But like, not since I started hunting. And so then we finally get some and I bring it back and I'm, you know, and it's one thing as somebody with like a big culinary background like mine.
Mm-hmm.
I knew from the processing, I was like, oh, this is going to be terrific meat, period. Just, I could tell by the quality of handling it and everything. And, but it, there's still a part of my mind was like, man, what if this shit sucks? And I'm going to be, this is going to devastate my whole world. And then I bit into it and I was like, oh my God.
Yeah.
This is exactly what I wanted and so much more.
I gave a couple of pieces to Casey. He had never had any venison before.
Really?
And so all he had even was just that, the shit that was microwaved the next day, and he was still like, that's fucking fire. And I was like, bro, it was so much better yesterday. Like, yeah, it was crazy.
That's awesome.
And
we'll talk about it at some point in the future, but I think I might gonna change my hunting game plan up this year to maximize chances at other animals like elk.
Yeah.
Bigger animals like elk, and it may involve not necessarily fulfilling my little deer tag, my specialty deer tag, because that's just, it's for a whitetail, and I'm like, it's in the middle of elk season. It's actually throughout, it's like 7 out of the 10 days of
I remember
season
you
or
saying
something.
That, yeah.
And I'm like, I might just get a, just do regular deer hunting around here. Open season or general season starts in about 2 weeks.
Is there, so I know like around Squim, there's like a fuckload of elk. Like, are you able to...
In Squim?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, in Squim, yeah.
Yeah. Is there a place around Squim that you can go and hunt?
Word.
Like, is that so people do that?
Yeah.
That's pretty common.
A lot of people do it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I, like, sometimes, you know, if you drive through at the right time, like, just the main highway into Squim, like, you will have to stop because there's so many fucking elk right there, like, up on that hill and shit.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, there's places over there. It gets tough kind of in the Olympic Peninsula because you're not allowed to hunt in national parks. And primarily
Word.
A lot of that is not national forest, it's national park.
Right.
There are a lot of areas, though, that you can, and it just
you can hunt in the national forest, but not the national park.
Mm-hmm.
That's so weird.
Most of the time, yeah. And then
hunting
but
is weird,
up
bro.
There, man, yeah, all those elk are a different type of elk than, like, if I went to the Cascades and hunted elk. Those are called Roosevelt elk.
Oh.
And they are monsters.
Yes,
they're basically
they're
horses with antlers.
They are enormous.
Exactly. And I want one of those.
Yeah.
So we have a western tag, my brother and I, this year. Western tag for elk, so we can do that, or we can hit part of the Western Cascades. But
I'm a big fan of that.
We'll figure it out, and then you'll get some elk meat.
Yeah, your brother's trying to get me out there with him already.
Oh, it's a good time.
I've had this conversation just like with John a lot, you know. Yeah. when he started getting into hunting and stuff like that, and trying to figure out that. I'm like, when all this started, I just had to like try and decide what felt like it was most important to me, you know what I'm saying? Whether I needed to get like the personal defense shit squared away or get like the hunting shit squared away, you know? And I personally felt like
you went one direction, I went another direction.
And I personally felt like if the world was to end, I can learn to hunt in the end anyway. But exactly. I can't necessarily go and fucking find armor plates and shit when the world is over. You know what I'm saying? But
this is a good point. This is a very valid point.
And if, you know, the forest rangers or whatever, wildlife rangers don't exist anymore, then there's no one to regulate what caliber or rifle I'm hunting with. So, I, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's like been a lot of people like, oh, like, yeah, no, an AR is cool, but like, you can't hunt with a 5.56. Like, unless nobody's regulating anything, then fucking
there's no government.
Hunt with this goddamn handgun and no one's going to say anything about it.
The entire government goes down because they're all 100 years old.
Exactly.
Oh my god.
Yeah, so let's start right here. So this week we're going to talk about mainly about the presidential debate. We're going to use this and all the different, you know, the 15 minute topics, six subjects, fucking whatever, and so we're going to talk about all those different things and use those kind of as branches to discuss larger topics. So we're going to talk a little bit about the Supreme Court.
Believe it or not, there were actual topics that were well they were supposed to be
hard
for
as
the
they
debates.
Were to discern
so
we're going to use that kind of as a vehicle to talk about other subjects. We are going to talk about the Supreme Court for a little bit. We're going to talk about COVID, obviously. We are going to talk about kind of the social unrest. We're going to talk about Donald Trump's taxes, all these different things that happened, and we're going to talk about sports a little bit because there's only two of us this week. So we have some time to talk about some sports.
And we got to talk fantasy.
Exactly. Yeah, we got some fantasy talk to go over. But I want to start here in the pre-show. It came out yesterday morning that President Trump tested positive for the coronavirus. And I remember reading Thursday night. I told you I read Thursday night that Hope Hicks had the coronavirus.
Yep.
And I was like, that's no good.
Not at all.
And then it was just the next morning. Because I saw that right before I went to bed. Like, I turned off Netflix, so it was just cable on my TV. And as that happened, Hope Hicks tested positive for coronavirus. And I was like, fuck. Like, that's not going to be good. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And then, yeah, so the next morning on Friday, I got up to go to work. So it was 4:45. You know what I'm saying? I went out. President Trump tested positive for coronavirus. It's like, fucking no shit. I knew it, right? And so now
it was really just a matter of time at that
point.
Oh,
certainly. Yeah. And then yesterday, Friday in the afternoon, there was reports that he was transported to Walter Reed Medical Center, and so he was there being treated. I saw this morning that he's not on oxygen.
Nope.
He does not have a fever and he seems to be doing just fine.
And he's on they've started the therapy remdesivir.
Yep. Yes.
And so he had his first dose, I believe, last night.
Yeah.
And I think it was in the post from Kaylee Mecken. No. This was from the doctors, I think, over at Walter Reed.
Yeah.
That said, yeah, he had his first dose and everything's doing well. And I think he even tweeted something about
it,
if I remember
right. I'm sure that he did. So with that has come, you know, a storm of what ifs and hypotheticals, but the craziest one I think that I saw this morning, I saw just before I came here, was that some people think he doesn't actually have the coronavirus.
Yeah, like the whole thing is just a hoax because he's just trying to come out of it and be like, oh, well, I had, you know, I'm 70 some years old and I'm this old crazy guy, supposedly, and y'all think I'm crazy and I got it and I'm just fine. So it really is nothing to worry about.
So I've seen that. I've also seen
that's a conspiracy
that theory. right I've also seen the theory that he's trying to get out of the debates, which I think is stupid because if he didn't want to do debates, he'd be like, I'm not fucking doing it. And then I've also seen
the
that
one guy that loves to fight with people doesn't want to fight with people.
I've also seen that it's to try and disrupt the media cycle to get Joe Biden off of the televisions. And I was talking to Jordan about this on the way here, and I was like, which doesn't make any sense because Donald Trump doesn't need TVs to like have people's attention. Like, he's tweeting and they're just fucking talking about him all the time. You know what I'm saying?
Okay, right there.
Like, and then Joe Biden has been fucking hiding in his basement like since January. So it's not like he's dominating the news cycle as it is. So you have to work super hard to like try and get him off. You know, anybody who's coming out after the debate and saying like, oh, Joe Biden, you know, undoubtedly won this, like, they're fucking lying. You know, anybody who's saying it either way is lying. So it seems that just doesn't, none of these things seem logical to me. I don't know what benefit Donald Trump would have from pretending to be sick when he's so focused on like being strong and like looking tough all the time. I don't know why he would want to pretend to be sick.
And I think as a general rule in today's media environment, if you find something that completely fits to your ideology's running narrative, it's probably bullshit.
Yeah.
Because both main narratives right and left right now are totally and utterly disingenuous and most of the time just flat out lie to people.
Right.
And so if you find that whatever you're hearing fits perfectly with your mindset and your narrative running forward, and it kind of just fits into whatever it is that you believe has been true for the last 4 years, it's probably not the way to go.
Yeah.
Because people are much more, you know, gray than that.
Yeah. So I do think it's very interesting. Obviously, my first, well, I said to you, was like, obviously, I don't want this, you know, but like, what if the fucking president dies? Like, that's, first of all, what if he dies before the election? Second of all, what if he dies after the election and he wins the election, right? Then America has Mike Pence for 4 years after they voted for Donald Trump.
Right? Yeah, and that's then a thing.
This morning when Jordan and I were talking about it again, I was like, and this is even more fucked up. I said, what if Donald Trump wins the election, right? And then him and Mike Pence both die from the coronavirus, and then Nancy Pelosi becomes the president, and the man who just won the election is now replaced by his ideological polar opposite. And that's who we live with for 4 years until they have another fucking election.
That's assuming Nancy Pelosi could fulfill a whole term.
Would that not be the craziest moment in American history? I said to Jordan, I said, whatever percentage of the vote Donald Trump won, whether it's like 46% or whatever, all those people, civil war, immediately. Those people are not going to live 4 years under Nancy Pelosi after they just voted for Donald Trump. There's no way.
Can you imagine?
I don't even, I might cry. Like, I might laugh and cry all at the same time. I don't even know what I would do. Obviously, after being fucking distraught that the president and the vice president died, but like the thought of Nancy Pelosi then taking the helm as president.
Yeah,
I point, don't even know.
If Pence isn't living in a bubble right now for just the continuity of government at this point, something's wrong.
Right.
So, motherfucker, he needs to be bubble boy right now.
I wonder just where he's at.
Not the fact that I love Pence, because I'm not a Pence fan.
Yeah.
But just for the sake of the longevity and survival of the nation, that dude needs to be in a box right now. Just airtight, air sealed, hang out in a bunker. What's the lone survivor? He's the designated lone survivor.
Designated survivor, yeah.
Exactly.
That's terrifying, bro. I don't even, like, Mike Pence, where are you? Wherever you are, fucking stay safe, Mike Pence, because...
Bro.
Good Lord. The last thing that we need is
that
Nancy Pelosi presidency.
And not even for like the substance of what
just, like,
that would bring,
just
the overall, like,
the way
just
everything
the fact
would be.
That we, the number three chairperson being her, would be in charge. That would just instant civil war. Done. It's over.
Yeah, I don't know what I would do.
I mean, yeah, that's not good. None of this is good.
We'd be talking your brother down from a ledge, man. I can't even hang on for the book, man. Chad, just fucking, it's okay.
Just wait, buddy. Just wait.
Give it a few days. Just wait.
Man. Yeah, so that's, I mean, it's legit scary, though.
Yes.
And there's a lot of people now.
2020 being undefeated.
Oh, fuck. 2020, man. Straight up. I'm done with it. I'm fucking done with it.
I told Although, you, 2020 is 9-0.
2021 is not going to get any better. No. None of it's going to get any better.
What if there's just a total 180 shift? 2021 is the best year that's ever happened in America.
I'll take it. I'll take it if it happens. For God's sakes, I want that.
Anything to deserve that. That's not about what we deserve. That's
we deserve exactly what we're getting.
Yeah,
that's exactly what we deserve. We did this to ourselves.
Man.
Just remember that because it's so close to the election. This is like a term that's always really bothered me. The low information voter. I've heard this term a lot.
Yeah.
And what that basically means. Don, what is a low information voter in your mind?
It's almost the same, almost synonymous with like a single issue voter. You know what I'm saying? Like you don't know, but this is the one thing that you know. Like this is all that I care about. This is all that I... And they're not totally synonymous, but almost. Mm-hmm. Because to vote because of one thing is never good. You know what I'm saying? And I feel that a low information voter generally is that they're maybe even just voting because of somebody's name. You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
Like I'm going to vote Donald Trump because fuck Nancy Pelosi, because fuck Joe Biden. You know what I'm saying? Or somebody who doesn't know either person's platform, but is voting for Joe Biden because they hate Donald Trump. That would be a low information voter.
So somebody who votes, like in my mind, it's somebody who votes that doesn't actually understand. understand what they're doing. They're yes. voting because they have a D or an R in front of their name, or yes. they're just that they're on my team, not the other team. Or like you said, maybe even single issue voters that generally may not even have a good understanding of what that issue is, because that happens a lot too.
Coming after again.
So in other words, low-information voters to me are just stupid people who shouldn't be voting anyways.
Yeah, probably.
But I mean, that's, but again, I mean, we've been over this before, the whole concept of the right to vote, right? The right to vote carries with it a responsibility
right.
to be an informed voter and to know what it is that you're doing.
Yeah.
And most people, I don't think, have a good understanding of that. A lot of people think they do, but I don't think a lot of people do. And I'm not going to pretend that I do either. I probably know more than the average Joe, I would say.
That's one of my favorite counterpoints from Steven Crowder and Ben Shapiro a lot of times. Mm-hmm. When piano, I'm sure it usually comes up when they're talking about abortion, but then they talk about like the right to vote, you know, mm-hmm. and how many women at that time like didn't want the right to vote because of all the things that you had to do if you were going to be voting, you know. Yeah. So there was many women that were very split along that path, and a lot of men obviously that had to work with them to ensure that that could get done. And so that's, I would think that that's
the original ally.
Yeah. So I think that that's very interesting, you know, it just is. The way that that was split, that like
yeah.
of having to, and the responsibilities I'm talking about, like having to do like fire patrol and like shit like that, you know, that came with like being a registered voter. You're mm-hmm. then have to take part in these other things. You know, the draft and shit like that, like those things are still things that we, issues that we're dealing with today, you know?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. But don't, women not the Selective being the Service don't, you know, they don't reach for the female.
Right.
You know, they, which is interesting because they don't have necessarily a problem with female, I don't want to say registration, but like signing up for the military. There's a right. lot of
you
women
in combat now. Yeah.
Tons. It's really interesting how
seen female Army Rangers and shit like that, and like just yeah. in the last couple of years, you know, like that's,
regular badasses.
Yeah, that's people that have beat my ass.
There's
know,
some
so.
Really interesting Instagram accounts that you can follow.
I'm highly worth sure it. That there are
terrifying. They look like MMA fighters. Some of them,
yeah,
that I follow on Instagram. They're like fucking just badass mercs, man.
Have you listened to the Joe Rogan with Cam Haines on it yet? The one that came out last week.
Just last night, oh, as a matter yeah. of fact.
And he was talking about those women that he's been running with, you know, and like falling asleep yeah. on the trail and shit like that. And that's
yeah. I was watching it last night when I was trying to get this whole streaming setup going on.
Yeah.
And yeah, I saw those pictures. They're fucking, they will wreck people, dude.
That ain't me, dog.
No,
that just isn't me. I just not don't. Either. I don't have that in my brain of like. Like, it's not that I don't have the ability to push past a level of uncomfortability, but I generally am like, no, I know
yeah,
that's
those people
not.
Are human.
Yeah, I have too much logic running through my brain that's like, you have to stop. Like, this is yeah. a bad idea. There's no benefit after this point. You know, like, you've already reached it, so just stop. Yeah.
Like, I'm going to run, what was that? One of the ladies ran 4 miles per hour. Until she couldn't run anymore. And like yeah. that was a competition that she was in with all these other people. I was like, why?
4 miles every hour.
Why?
Just for as long as she could.
Yeah. Just for as long. Yeah, until you drop.
Yeah.
And like all them ultra marathon people that are
yeah.
running hundreds of miles
and
without
yeah.
stopping.
Right. And then the other woman, yeah, who was trying to go like over 400 miles like in less than a week. You know what I'm saying? So
why?
She's like not sleeping at all. And they literally had to make her stop because she's like had like 80% oxygen rate. You know yeah. what I'm saying? Like you will die if you continue to run. Like you,
yeah.
It's crazy that people are able to like, because your brain and your body have self-preservation mechanisms. You know, like you will fall asleep because your body's like, I can't. Like yeah. I can't do it anymore. And it's crazy that people are able to get through those points to fight the self-preservation mechanisms too. And yep. they use the example of like a dog and a horse. You know, if you find
oh, yeah.
the right dog, the right horse will run itself to death. That yeah. type of shit happens. Horses work to
easy.
Death. Yeah. Right. So dogs are harder to find that will run themselves to death, but certainly
I know
the right dog, you know what I'm
Chloe
saying?
Will do that.
Yeah.
If there's a ball involved, she will fetch until her heart gave out.
Yeah.
I mean, there was days where we had done it before where, like, didn't realize she got too worked up, you know, she's been running too long or something like that, and then she can't walk for a week.
Yeah.
Like, she's limping real hard, and it's like, dog, what are you doing? Don't do it if it hurts you. So now we just don't do that at all.
And it's crazy that there are people that are able to get...
All the cameras, bro.
Are able to break that. You know, they're able to get past those things. And I mean, I would feel comfortable saying that we evolved those mechanisms in our brain to continue to live. To live for as long as possible.
Because if there's one thing we're good at, it's surviving.
Yeah, and those people are able to literally, like, break their brains to just
I'm just gonna shut this going. Off real quick.
And that's crazy. That is, I don't even know what I want to call it, but like impressive is definitely part of it, you know, but it's also like it's so stupid though. But but I don't know. It's impressive is probably the best. It's probably the only word that could be used for it.
Well, because impressive could be like you can be impressed and have good or bad connotations either way, right? So like I think that's very appropriate.
Yeah.
That is so funny. So what else are we gonna talk about? We're gonna talk about debates, and that can lead off into a billion things.
Yeah,
we're gonna talk
about a lot of stuff. There was one thing that I wanted to ask you about during the pre-show.
Word.
Boeing.
Lay it on me.
Boeing. Right? Boeing. So a bunch of new jobs that they've announced that are leaving the state, right?
Bye bye.
And so just over the last two or three days I've heard clips from like Jay Inslee being asked about it, right? And so Jay Inslee has said some things that I think are very interesting, right?
Yeah.
So certainly totalitarian. Being upset, there's a lot of obviously a lot of benefit to for Boeing and for Washington for them being here, but he's saying shit like that, like
we have
like,
a bank that was or a credit union that was started just because Boeing existed.
I am a member of BECU,
and it's a wonderful, it's a great wonderful institution.
Yeah, and so Jay Inslee has said shit like Boeing owes its employees, like it owes the citizens of Washington for building this company. And let's just start here, because anybody who maybe hasn't watched the show before, I work for a small company. I work for a small manufacturer who treats me extremely well. I 1,000% understand the relationship, you know, worker-boss relationship, right?
Yep.
But
employee-employer.
Also know that if you work for Boeing, you have a great fucking benefits package, you make really good money, and you have a great fucking job. You're also part of a fantastic union, right?
Oh, yeah, one of the most powerful, too. Ensures
everybody is fucking good to go, right? So even as a worker from an ununionized company, I am fucking shocked to hear a governor say that a company owes something to the people that it has employed and fairly compensated for the entirety of their employment, right? If Tim and Dan were to decide to leave and go to another state and hire a bunch of other people, certainly I'll be upset. But as long as I've been treated fairly during this time, and I'm then going to get my, you know, my fucking...
You get a severance package.
Exactly, right, a severance package. That's what I'm looking for. Yeah, a decent severance package. At that point, what the fuck else does this company owe me? They don't owe me...
All the free market, baby.
What the fuck? That was crazy to me. I could not believe that he was saying that. We owe them. Like, that they owe us. And like, oh, we're going to...
Does it surprise you that a governor said that? Or does it surprise you that Governor Inslee said that?
I think it surprised me that a governor said that. Okay. Right?
Because that doesn't surprise me that Inslee says that. Yeah, maybe not necessarily Inslee. Because he is Lord Emperor Inslee. And that's the way the vast majority of people to his ideological bent lean these days, is very centralized control.
Right.
And he's highly upset that a giant company that he has very little control over, but he has a lot of control over, like, taxes and financial right. well-being or permitting of all this, you know, everything that is involved with this company. And he can be like, no, fuck you. I'm out. You pissed me off because you're not doing what I want you to do. Free, you know, far be it from you to actually like want to participate in a free market. Far be it from me to tell you that, yeah, this is a free market society and you can do business and reap the consequences of whatever it is that you choose to do as a company.
Right.
No. I don't like what you're doing because of my ideology. So fuck you. Now we're going to try to beat the shit out of you financially through taxes and shit.
And we've talked about Boeing before. I don't have any particular sympathy for Boeing, especially in this time, getting money from the government. You're like, oh, we're fucking struggling airlines and shit. Like, you sold planes that didn't work and you knew it. That's what you fucking get, right? I appreciate them. Obviously, they're a huge part of the state, all kinds of stuff, right?
They're a huge part of the world.
I get it, right? Yeah. I get it. I also thought, because James Lee also said, like, well, they didn't ask or say anything to us about, like, you know, what we could do to try and work out some type of, like, thing for them to do. First of all, Boeing doesn't owe you shit. They don't owe you anything. Like, that's, it doesn't work that way, right? Because they have so much to offer, you have provided them tax incentives for them to stay here. The same thing you're doing with fucking Amazon in Seattle.
Which I think on its level is a level of corruptness between the private sector and the public sector, which I think we should all have a serious fucking problem with.
Yes, but in,
but far be it from us to call that out.
From
that's
a governmental perspective, right? As Jay Inslee, as the executive of the state, is it not your job? Because you know Boeing is struggling. Everybody in the world knows that Boeing is struggling, right? Is it not also your job to be like, hey, what are you, what's going on? What can we do? Do you need help? Is there, like, are you going to go somewhere to ask, to try and get, to fucking use something, to check the temperature inside of Boeing to see if they're thinking about, they've already sent a bunch of jobs to the place. They've already fucking fired a bunch of people. So is we know that. I don't know where they're going, but this is the second group of, like, the second production line that they're sending to another place, right?
Is this for the Dreamliner and 787?
Yeah, so we've already seen this. Yeah. Why are you not actively involved in a conversation with Boeing to try and understand what's going on there? Why, instead, your idea is that Boeing should be asking you if... That just seems crazy to me, that this private company should then lean on the state government so much to... suck more from the teat, like more of the teat into their mouth. I don't get, like, that seems so weird.
Well, then I thought we were really pissed at, I mean, I'm just saying we as in Inslee and the government of the state and the counties in that area. I thought we were all really pissed about them not paying any taxes and shit anyways. Right. So fuck them. But I guess not, because actually they realized that the thousands of people that work for Boeing rely on that.
Yeah.
And the government needs their tax money just actually more than they need, obviously, the corporation of Boeing's tax money.
Right.
But none of it really matters, because there is no, there's no logic behind it when they do these things. It's all incredibly impulsive.
Oh,
it's
certainly.
It's all very, very corrupt. It's all very instinctual.
Right.
And it's
right.
Like, wait.
Right.
Because why is this happening?
Right.
Motherfucker, it's been happening for decades, asshole.
Already, Jay Inslee said he's going to reevaluate, you know, the tax, you know, involvement, the incentives that are going on with Boeing, because they're going to move these places, and chose not to say anything to the state, you know?
And you know what's funny is, if you never gave them a tax break when they started to be here,
yeah,
they would probably still be here. And they would be paying fucking taxes, and they wouldn't have leverage over you. They don't have leverage over the executor of the entire state of Washington. But they do, because of what you did decades, well, not him, just, you know, our government, our state government in general, what we did to them decades and decades ago. It was like, oh yeah, well, let's just give them these nice tax breaks so they stay here, and then they can help boost. If you just would have kept their taxes standard, whatever it was, like, I don't know, just throw 10% out there, just because I like a nice flat tax. Pretend we live in this world, you know. We could, if they were always paying 10%, they would have built their business model off of that. But they've built their business model off of not having to pay these kind of taxes, and now you can't just force it on them because you don't like what they're going to do as a corporation, because they're trying to survive,
right,
and move someplace else, because the shit show of our state doesn't, it's not financially viable to be here anymore.
Well, and I do find it interesting that the Democratic Party, that tends to argue that corporations are not paying enough in taxes, or, like you said, are the ones that are offering. If you look at just Washington and California, for example, the big companies, you know, Jeff Bezos doesn't pay enough taxes. Like, Amazon doesn't pay enough taxes. Google doesn't pay enough taxes. You know what I'm saying? But these are the companies that you're offering enormous fucking tax breaks to stay in this area.
Yeah.
Like, so I don't understand it's even a feasible argument to make that they're not paying enough when you're not requesting that they pay everything that they should pay in the first place, because you're going to give them $100 million in tax breaks to, like, exist here.
Yeah.
$100 million a year in taxes that they don't have to pay just because they're choosing to be here? That's fucking crazy.
And that's a call that they, as the government, have to choose to make from the get-go.
That's crazy.
You cannot destroy a private company or attempt to destroy a private company because you don't like the decision that you made and put towards them years and years and years ago.
Right.
And it doesn't work like that.
And there's an argument to be made that... Oh, you know, if we don't offer to them, someone else is going to. But like you said, that lends to the argument of it being corruption.
Yeah.
That if nobody was doing it, then it wouldn't be a problem. But it's the same idea as, like,
That's why I like flat tax.
That, like, like OPEC, right? That's maybe that's not the right thing, but like all of the group of the different Arab company or Arab nations that sell their oil. You
let's
know
just
saying?
Call it OPEC then, at that point.
Yeah,
because it's more than just that. It's like it's, a couple of the
it's
other
like,
ones.
It's like the global oil the market, right? Yep. That they agree on a set price,
which
and
is
then
literally
eventually
called a cartel. It is a cartel.
Right. And then eventually one of those countries decides they're going to sell it for a dollar less a barrel, and it fucks everything up.
Oh, yeah.
But if you all just fucking do the right thing and sell it for how much you're supposed to sell it for, everything will be good. It's the same idea. Yep. If you just don't fucking give any tax breaks, they're just going to have to pick where they want to be, and it's just going to be based on that. But if one person decides they're going to be corrupt and sell it for a dollar less or offer $100 million in tax incentives because they want that money... That's exactly how everything gets fucked up.
And it's still, it's legal corruption.
Yeah.
It's legal corruption.
It's
and
dark.
And we've allowed it to go on for decades and decades, which is why we're in the exact situation we are in now.
Yeah.
Legal corruption. And
that's
I think...
very interesting.
If you have anything else, we've been going for 35 minutes.
Yeah, no, that's the last thing that I wanted
I
to
like
talk about.
I like having this up here. I can have a timer. I can see all the comments. This is killer.
Oh, Makai's music. Yes, Makai did drop
course.
Some new music. Yeah, absolutely.
He did?
Yes.
Popping on
yes,
Twitter.
Yes, yes.
I saw that shit.
Yeah, let's see. That's what I want to pull up the name real quick.
Yeah, likewise. I was going to pull up the actual thing.
Yes.
Oh, my God.
Change My Life. That's what it's called. Yeah, and it's fantastic. They've been making all kinds of great music lately. That's you're going to put it up on your camera there. Thank you.
And follow this
Yeah, they've been
right
making
there.
Fantastic music lately. All the time. John was here 2 weeks ago. They were talking about when I saw Elijah the week before that. You know, he was talking about that they have another music video in the works. So
I'm so excited.
Yeah. And when he was here, he was saying that they had a bunch of content, you know, that they've.
Oh, yeah. They've just been sitting on.
You know? Yeah. So they've obviously got something big going on. You know, they're
I like the idea of stacking a library.
They're not by any means simple-minded men. You know what I'm
hard
saying?
No.
So I am hard-pressed to believe that they don't have an elaborate plan set up for the next fucking... I don't know this. I don't. I'm not... But
if
that they don't have a plan for the next
chess
6
nowadays?
Months, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. For like, oh, well, we're going to drop this. And then 6 weeks later, we're going to drop this. And 6 weeks later, we're going to drop this. And then we're going to hit this video. And then we're going to do this. I know I've... have to believe they have some form of plan laid out here, and we are just
along
subject
for the
to the whim of the upper left.
That's right.
And they are incredible content. Let's just go ahead and tag just some of them here.
Buckle up, baby. It's
yeah,
going to get real.
Them. So let me just at Elijah.
At Elijah. Yeah. At one dot. I definitely can't be in the band.
The moment let me do it because it's fucking... I hate Facebook. This is
likewise.
Such a piece of shit. I hate Facebook. Fuck Facebook. As soon as we're available, we're getting off this piece of shit. I don't remember if anybody remembers fucking a couple weeks ago when I tried to literally give Facebook money so that they could promote our shit, and they were like, sorry, we can't do it, even though, you know, there's no strikes against your account and you don't have anything like that. There's nothing that would hinder you from doing that. I still have not received an email to indicate why they wouldn't take my money, Facebook. I want to give you fucking money. I don't get it. That seems so weird. Like, you so badly don't want objective and honest opinions to be released that you're just not even going to fucking take money. You're not even going to allow... You're just going to cut capitalism out of this process completely. Like, I'm not even going to take your money. Fuck it. I'm just... Fuck your money.
Yeah, it's old Zuck don't like capitalism,
so,
bro.
Yeah, not that YouTube is any better, but I don't know.
But I will say this. If everything goes good... I think next show, instead of streaming on Facebook live stream, we can do a live stream on YouTube.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure I have everything set up on the YouTube end.
Good.
I just need to do it on our end, and we can try that
and
next week. So, if you're watching this right now, then just look forward to watching us on YouTube live next time. And hopefully I'll have some cool overlays by then, too, so we can look even more legit.
Yeah. So let's say we're out here obviously watching us on our Facebook fucking Facebook at Salt of the Streets. We have our Instagram at Salt of the Streets, our YouTube at Salt of the Streets that we'll be on next week, and you can find all of our videos, all of everything. These videos will be up next week. We have our personal social media. I'm at Salt of the Street on Twitter and at alpaca_Don on Instagram. He's at Big Bird Offie on both of those things. You can find all of this information on saltofthestreets.com. It's a beautiful website. It's fantastic. It's We're going to record the real episode now. Look out for it on Monday and then the videos later in the week. Thank you. Go listen to Makai's music. Go listen to Upper Left's music. Nils, Denzel, One Dot. That's it. We're done. Out of here. We're done. Peace out. Have a good weekend, everybody.
Now, how do I shut this off? That's
I don't know. Somebody go shoot a deer. Legally. Shoot a deer legally. End the video, Colin.
There it is. I was like, where did it go? I can't find my thing.
End the video, Colin.
Rate the quality of the broadcast. Sure, why not?
You like my own or just like the quality?
Right? I did great.